continuing our conversation with the great Rosie O'Donnell. She was here yesterday. She's back today. Her new movie, America, premieres tomorrow night at 9 p.m. on Lifetime. So, please welcome Rosie O'Donnell.
All night.
It's getting better every day.
It's not as easy as it looks, that runway on this show.
So we had fun yesterday. Thanks for coming back today.
My pleasure. Thank you for having us.
Yesterday we played a fun game. It revealed Rosie's thoughts on a variety of topics, and it was really fun. So I want to play it again.
Okay, here we go. Get me in trouble. What do I got to say?
So we got Rosie's opinions.
All right.
Okay. Okay, here we go. I want to ask you about celebs being attacked for their weight, because I'm famously one of those.
Yeah, which is hard for me to believe, because looking at you, I'm like, please, people. But
yeah, I'm 160 pounds right now is the weight of when my pictures were taken.
Really?
Yeah.
I'm 222.
Yeah, don't we love
this? Come on,
embrace the number. Embrace the number. So many women are scared to say the number. I say, just say it.
You know, I think that show, The Biggest Loser, has really helped, because for a long time, everyone lied, even celebrities. You'd see them on TV going, oh, I'm 180. Cut to that show where women who look the same size as you are on there with getting weighed in a sports bra. And, like, there's no more illusion, people. You know, so I love when celebrities still try to lie.
To lie.
And say, oh, I'm really porking up. I'm almost 190. I'm thinking, my ass, you're 190. You know? That's my goal weight, honey. But, yeah, you know, it's a tough thing. And you just really hope that kids today are able to, especially young girls, feel their strength as a woman and as a female in our society, when it's so hard. You know, all my kids are fit, which is interesting, probably because they're all adopted. They don't have my gene pool. But they help me with my weight.
Yeah.
So after Halloween, they go to me, Mom, we're hiding our bags.
The Halloween bags.
They hide their candy. They know for me the month of November is hell, because I'm in my bed and it's 11:15 and I'm thinking there are raisinettes down one flight. So they hide them. And I just came back from Miami last week with my little 9-year-old, and we were on the boat and he ran in to get a drink. And I said, buddy, you know, get me a water and get me a Hershey bar. And he stopped and he turned around and he said, Mom, surely we can eat something more healthy than that. He's 9 years old. So I think that, you know, celebs are...
It's, you know, I find crazy. I find that a celeb, they can go kill their wife. They can, go all kind of drugs, all kind of crazy stuff, and come back, no problem.
Yeah.
Woo, gain 15 pounds.
Mm-hmm.
I know. Blasphemous.
I always feel bad, especially for the ones who are sex symbols and, you know, like you or whoever, that they are supposed to look some kind of way, you know?
Are you on Facebook?
No.
You're not?
No, because
I would so want to be your friend on Facebook.
Really?
I would told you should set up a fake account and, like, we could just be friends on Facebook. I'm obsessed with it now. I have, like, a fake name
on there. Well, my brother just signed himself
I'm not gonna
up.
Tell y'all the name.
And he sent me something that said, click here, and I clicked and I think I was on. I don't know what happened. I think I may have an account and I'm not even sure of it. But my kids go to a school where you're not allowed to watch TV, part of the contract you sign with the school, or go on the computer. So we're not really well versed in that kind of.
Oh.
But people tell me that it's addictive.
Oh my God, I'm going to show you after the show.
Okay, show
me. It's crazy. You can find all your friends from elementary school, junior high school. Who would you want to find in high school, Rosie?
In high school, maybe Todd Bishop.
Todd Bishop.
I loved him. He was a very artistic kind of guy, and he was kind of always teased and picked on, but I bet he's like some fantastic designer or architect, or he always had style, that kid.
Todd Bishop.
Todd Bishop, where are you?
Go to tyrashow.com, Todd Bishop.
Yeah, Todd Bishop.
Rosie O'Donnell's looking for you.
Yeah, that would be interesting, though. Do you get flooded by people?
Well, I'm under a fake name, so I do a little secret thing and tell them it's me, but I'm like, don't post this on your wall-to-wall or your comments. Does that make sense? Yeah.
Oh.
I'm like, keep it on the down low.
Well, that's what I got, a little letter that said, your brother Eddie is on the wall. I'm thinking, what wall? What are you talking about? You know, I didn't even know. But
why did you quit your blog? We used to, like, every day on the talk show, we would go on the blog and see, like, your video blogs. I loved it.
I know. It was so much fun. When I started doing it, like, 6 years ago, nobody really knew what a blog was.
Yeah, they didn't.
And I'd go on talk shows and say, I have a blog. And they're like, what? But then it got very commonplace. And with Facebook, it's sort of similar to your own blog, I guess, right? And I didn't like that entertainment shows in the evening would take just a part of it and here she is, Crazy Rosie again, and they'd roll it, and then people would call, why did you say that? I'm like, oh, forget it.
Yeah.
I'm doing it now, really, to talk more about the philanthropic things that I'm doing, and occasionally when there's something adorable I can't resist, mm-hmm. I'll put it up.
Do you keep a personal journal, like a diary?
I definitely do.
You do? I'm so scared to keep one.
Really?
Yes, I'm scared, like, it's going to get out. I have some crazy journals from when I was in high school. I'm like, I can only imagine if I was writing now.
Yeah.
So how do you do it and keep it secret? You have a secret stash? A
little... I have like those red books, the Daily Journal. They're pretty big, and
yeah.
they have the year on them, and each day written, and you could write and put pictures in there. So it's kind of great. I could like grab the one from 2000 and look through and see like Parker as a baby,
uh-huh.
and you know, show them pictures and what I was doing. And but I love to do that because it's good for me to remember where I was a year ago or what was happening. I don't really think about locking them up too much, but now that you mention it, I could get paranoid and get a safe.
What was your toughest year of your whole entire life?
1973, when my mom died.
Oh.
Yeah, that's like a dividing line for me.
Wow.
You know, 1973, it's like all the color went away.
Mm.
It was like I was living, you know, a color, and then it all, like the Wizard of Oz, just became black and white.
Mm-hmm.
And then when my son arrived in 95, the color was infused again.
Wow.
And it was like the most magical thing
yeah.
ever. So those are the two lines, March 73 and May 95.
Okay, I'm going to switch up a little bit. What do you think about Whitney Houston coming back?
I hope and pray to God that she does and can. I often have dreams that I go on tour with her, and I open for her, and she comes out and does a set, and then I'm on the backup. Clap your hands, y'all, it's all right. Clap your hands, y'all, it's all right. I think she's unbelievably talented.
Yeah, she sang at some Grammy parties. They said she was fantastic. She did a medley and all that stuff. She did the whole thing.
I don't think there was ever a voice like that of our generation.
I agree.
And, you know, she's had some really tough times, and I think the worst thing was that Bobby Brown show. Oh, dear Lord in heaven. I can't even. The fact that she would have seen that and said, fine, put it on. That's how you know maybe she had some drug issues. But, you know, everybody has issues. This here's the thing. Every human that you know struggles with the same thing.
Mm-hmm.
Addiction to what? Food? You eat too much? Or alcohol? Or drugs? Or sex? Or the internet? This is part of the human condition. And you see people who are able to go further than the addiction and go on and achieve amazing things. And I hope that for Whitney Houston.
Yeah, I'm addicted to Facebook, I swear.
You are? You're addicted to Facebook?
I just went on right before the show. I was like, I know Rosie's coming out, but I gotta go, I gotta
did
go,
you
I gotta
have
check.
Any new friends on your wall or something?
I did have new friends from, like,
really?
Elementary school.
And do you, like, you put in, do people believe that it's you, or is it?
I have to do secret things that only they know I would remember.
Oh.
That's what you have to do, Rosie. So when you find, what is his name, Todd?
Todd Bishop.
Todd Bishop, make sure you say some stuff that only Todd
I'll
would
say,
know.
Remember Billy Sheeran in eighth grade when he tripped you on the way out of football? Send.
Exactly.
Right, right.
I gotta ask you about the Jonas Brothers. They are, like, the biggest phenomenon
in
the
world. Oh, yeah, they're huge. They're big. And my niece, Katie, she is just addicted to them, and it was one of the best things that I could give her. You know, my best friend is Jackie. She's been my best friend since I'm three, and I went across the street at three, and I knocked on her door, and I said, do you have anyone here who's three? And her mother said yes, and I went
in.
Are
you serious?
And we're best friends still. She
wow.
lives 15 minutes from me. So her daughter Katie is 16 now, and she said, you know, we tried to get Jonas Brothers tickets and we couldn't, and Jackie's always going, you know, you shouldn't just get her everything. You always get her everything. It's not right of you. I'm like, I know, it's horrible. I went behind her back. I got her, like, third row Jonas Brothers, and she called me from there. It's the best night of my life. I gotta go. Click. But I think that they're fantastic.
Yeah.
There's always groups like that. I don't know if you're way too young. Does anybody remember the DeFranco family? Yeah. Heartbeat is a love beat. I was obsessed with the DeFranco family, but I think the Jonas Brothers may last a little longer.
Yeah. Okay, tell me about tomorrow night at 9 p.m. on Lifetime.
Yes.
What's that about?
That's the movie, America, that when 2001, right before my show ended, a staff member handed me a teen novel on the way out to go to a flight to L.A. I read the book on the way to L.A. I was in L.A. for 2 days, and by the time I flew home, I had written the script. So it was so good, and it won all kinds of awards for literature for teens. And
I didn't know you wrote the script.
I did.
Rosie!
Yeah.
I didn't know that.
And I called the writer, who was E.R. Frank was the writer. I didn't know man or woman. It was a woman
uh-huh.
who is a social worker who works with kids, and she's just had her first baby. Wonderful lady. And she came over to my house, and I said, I don't know how I'm going to do it, but I promise you I will get this movie made. So once we got the green light in November, I called her up. I said, guess what? You're going to fly to Detroit. We're filming this movie. She said, guess what? I'm 9 months pregnant, and I can't come. She just had her baby boy, and it's a wonderful, wonderful story about foster care. It's very accurate.
Take a look at this clip. America.
Liza's gone.
Yeah, but she's gonna be okay.
Did you really tell her that cutting yourself lets all the pain you have inside out?
Yes, I did. But you don't have to cut yourself to let all the pain out.
What else can you do?
You talk to someone. Someone you trust. And that's why I'm here.
A beautiful boy. We'll be right back. Rosie O'Donnell is telling us about her new movie, America, which you can catch Saturday, February 28th on Lifetime. It's a very emotional story about a young man who's been in and out of the foster care system and the toll that it's taken on him. Now, I have to ask you, where does your passion come from? When it comes to foster care, where does that come from for you?
Well, in 97, I was in Miami, and Parker was just a little boy, and there was a five-year-old girl who was raped and beaten in a one-bedroom apartment in Little Havana. Mm. And I somehow couldn't get it out of my head. And the doctor came to our house because Parker was sick, and I asked him, because he was at that hospital, if he knew the girl. And his college roommate happened to be her doctor. And I don't believe there are any coincidences, mm-hmm. you know, so I arranged to meet her, and she was in a residential treatment facility for kids who were severely abused and who were in foster care. And it broke my heart to see there were toddler beds in this, you know, room for sexually abused kids. Mm-hmm. And I met this young girl and talked to her a little bit about her life, and I met all the other girls there. And when I left that facility, I applied to become a foster parent. And you have to take a course and get licensed. And
how long does the course take?
It takes a few months, you know, to 6 months. You have to go and get your home also certified so that, you know, the pool is covered and things that you don't have to do for your own kids. You know, you give birth to a kid, nobody checks. But you want to take a kid that is abandoned and in need of a home, you have to pass a lot of hurdles. But I think it's a good thing because you don't want, needless to say, the wrong people getting these kids. And then I was back visiting that other girl, and there was a brother and sister holding hands. They were the cutest kids I'd ever seen in my life. And the social worker told me they had been in 30 foster homes.
Oh, my gosh.
And they were 3 and 5 years old. And
what?
So I did not tell Kelly, which I don't advise to people who are in a relationship. I put them in my car and took them home.
Oh, my gosh.
Yes, yeah, so it was a little bit of a big bite I took out of that hamburger.
Yeah.
And so the young boy stayed with us just a little while and then was placed in a special home for he had special needs. Mm-hmm. And the young girl we had for about a year and a half, and we inquired about adopting her, but that's when we found out in the state of Florida, gay people are not allowed to adopt the foster children they raise.
Really?
Yes. And so we went with the civil liberties, the ACLU, and we did a class action lawsuit to try to change that, and it just recently now has been changed. But that little baby girl, whose name is also Rosie.
Her name's Rosie?
Yeah.
How's she doing?
She's doing great, and my friends, Eileen and her husband, they adopted her. They have an older son, Kevin, and we see her frequently, and she's doing really great, and it's a good ending to that.
Good, because as soon as you just said that, I got crushed
for a
second.
I was not able to let her go back. It felt like I was on a, you know, the QE2, and here's a little baby with swimmies, and I was going to throw her in the ocean.
Yeah.
I couldn't do it, and, you know, luckily we got the court system to work in a way. She was transferred to New Jersey, and my friends who were trying to adopt, you know, we made a transition, and she's still in our family, so that's
the
a good
older
thing.
A kid gets, it's definitely harder for them to get permanently
without
adopted,
without a doubt.
Right?
And a large percent of kids who are up for adoption are, believe it or not, under the age of 8. Mm-hmm. And a lot of people think that, you know, the vast majority are teens, but there are many kids who are taken away at birth because the mother has either tested positive for drugs or has a history of child abuse.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, some of those kids just need a safe place to land for a little while, just a respite. And some of them need permanent homes.
Tell me, what is it, 8 out of 10 kids that exit the foster system, that age out, 8 out of 10 of them what?
End up either dead in jail or on the streets. And 30,000 kids every year age out of foster care in America. 30,000.
So what can we do about that?
We need the federal government to really change the law and to provide more services, not only to these kids, but to the people who are trying to help them and take care of them. You know, oftentimes you take a kid from foster care, the kid has been through such traumatic events and they're quite troubled, and you need a lot of attention and a lot of extra help. And in our society, with all the cuts, it's just not funded.
I hear a lot about a lot of abuse in foster homes. Is that prevalent?
Sadly, that's true. because oftentimes people do it for the money. Now, mm-hmm. it's hard for people who are trying to place kids to know which people are doing it for the money. And you hear these horror stories. There was a young boy, Fahim Williams, found dead in Newark, New Jersey, handcuffed to his twin brother, who was still alive.
Oh, my God.
And the mother was in jail, and she gave the kids to her sister, who could not take care of them, and chained them up in the basement. Now, listen, these are horror stories that happen all the time, but abuse does occur. And mm-hmm. in some states, in Florida, I think you get $11 a day to care, feed, and clothe a child that you're taking care of in foster care. So if somebody is doing it for the money, $11 a day is not going to go very far, mm-hmm. so they take a sibling family of five. And that's $55 a day. And the cabinets are locked, and the kids live in one room, and one mattress. And there are horror stories mm-hmm. that you can't believe these kids survive. The fact that they age out is a testament to their resilience.
That they
the
are
fact
surviving.
That they survive to be 18
yeah.
without a home in 30 different homes, some of which are very unsafe.
Mm-hmm. We'll be right back. Foster kids, you know, with Rosie, and foster kids, a lot of the times they're kind of nameless, they're faceless. There's just like a topic that we talk about.
Right.
So Rosie and I are going to actually go out, and we're going to introduce you all to some beautiful foster kids, and we're going to do a very fun activity with the kids. And actually, Rosie and I, we're going to create something together. Very
yes.
special.
I can't wait.
All right. So we're about to do it right now. We'll see you guys in a sec.
All right.
We're going now.
Knowing how much Rosie loves art and our combined passion for helping kids, I decided to create a space where six foster kids from the New York Foundling will be able to express themselves through art.
Hi.
Hi.
Ooh. You know Tyra Banks?
Yes.
She's a supermodel.
Retired.
You're still a supermodel. Once a supermodel, oh.
Am I gonna be 80 and they're gonna be saying supermodel?
Honey, that's not such a bad thing. It's not like we're saying you're a Cabbage Patch Kid or something. All right, get out, Ashley. We met you. Okay. What's your name?
Sininji.
Oh, I like
nice.
It.
Sininji.
It sounds like an African country.
Sininji.
Nice to meet you, pal.
Hello, you want on the talk.
Thank you so much.
Don't mention one of my bad movies. Okay. I loved you in Halloween 8, Tyra!
What's your name?
Francis.
You know Tyra Banks?
Yes.
Superstar, supermodel?
Yes.
There she is.
Here's Rosie. Star of the Flintstones.
Woo!
Good in that.
Oh, Wilma.
Yeah.
Once we were past introductions, it was time for the kids to step up into my photo studio.
Check it out like this. Love it, love it. Beautiful.
Their pictures will be used as an accent in the artwork that they will create.
Oh, that's cool. I like that one. This one, I like.
And they are free to express themselves.
Good, go dig deep.
Any way they want.
Good, good, good. Perfect, you're pro.
It was time to get to know the kids better.
Let's see your picture.
Beautiful, look at that smile.
Okay, let's see your picture. Very nice.
I was just smiling, thinking about being happy.
And having Rosie around, it was not hard to break the ice.
Did you hear that burp? I just had a chicken Caesar, and I totally tasted it in my mouth.
Was it good?
Yeah, it was nice.
Time around.
It was like a snack. I just had a snack.
We learned about their heritage.
¿Hablas español?
Sí.
¿Te gusta Nueva York?
Me encanta.
Yo hablo español, estudia en escuela. Yo no es conozco mucho palabras.
Oh, very good, Rosie.
Porque yo estupido.
And we heard about the people they missed in their lives.
My grandfather passed when I was really young, and he was like the only male guy that was there consistently in my life.
My mom, I love my mom.
And you still get to see your mom a lot?
Not as much. She suffers from schizophrenia. They just basically said that she wasn't able to take care of me.
I know that you said that some people have like connected you to that, and they said that, you know, that you have the same disorder as your mom, like people teasing you,
yeah.
right? What do you want to tell them?
What I want to tell them?
Yeah, because I know it hurts.
I'm not my mom. I'm Francis. So I could be me, and that's it.
I know you say that you have problems trusting people.
Because I have trust, put my trust in people, and they let me down. I'm not going to trust you, and I'm not going to let you get too close to me. So so we can have that trust, and then you end up hurting me again.
Even though Jessica and Patrick are siblings, they don't really know each other well.
And are you too close? Are you too?
We're growing back the connection. Like, even though, you know, we've always been together, but it still wasn't like a brother. I was there to believe I was the only child because, like, I stayed in a stable home for 7 years.
Now that you're adults and you're both sort of...
Yeah, so
time and time. Yeah, time and time, you know. I still want to focus doing what I do, what I want to do, you know.
Exactly.
Rosie, on my talk show, she talked about a lot of foster families and homes wanting just a paycheck. And I know you felt like that with some of the homes that you're in.
To be honest, I think I've only been in one house where there were caring people there. For the most part, everyone just thinks about the money that comes in.
A hardship that all foster kids face is that when they reach a certain age, they are no longer part of the system. This is commonly referred to as aging out.
And I know that you're aging out, right? You said that you're scared.
Yeah, I was scared at one point because I didn't know what I was going to do with my life because I had nobody to turn to. And then, you know, and then when I met my mentor, he was there every day. He was there for me every day. And I see him as a father to me more than a mentor.
It's heartwarming to find out that throughout their struggles, they still have a great outlook on life.
I want to be happy. To me, the depth of my struggle determines the height of my success.
And that's very true.
And that's why I live by.
1, 2, 3, hey!
We'll be right back. Rosie and I had gotten to know 6 kids who grew up in the foster care system, and it was time for them to start expressing their feelings on the canvases set before them. And don't worry, y'all, Rosie and I are getting our hands dirty, too. Got right to work. Rosie and I couldn't help but notice Francis's painting, which was inspired by Van Gogh's Starry Night.
That's beautiful, Francis.
Yeah, very nice.
She explained to us what the painting meant to her.
And when I was in care, most of the times when I couldn't sleep, I'd look out my window and I thought about the stars and how nice the stars would be if one day I get out of care.
Do you know there's a song about it? Starry, starry night. The writer looked at that painting and was captivated by it, too. Did you write a poem?
Yeah. If only you knew how to take the pain away, if only you knew the right words to say. If only you knew my love for you was true, if only you knew how much faith I had in you. If only you knew my love for you was strong, but now you know all my love for you is gone.
That's beautiful. Do you think maybe there would be someone in your life who would be able to know ever?
I'm doing it slowly and slowly, but it takes a process because I get attached to people real fast.
And they have to earn it.
You said, Sunungi, that your canvas would look dark and depressing.
I kind of changed my mind now. I kind of like crazy colors just all together in one.
That's great. Sometimes when I start a canvas at home, I don't know what it's going to be. And when I'm done, I kind of understand more what I was feeling by looking at what I've done.
That's what I do when I write poems, because I write poetry also.
I write poems myself. I started when I was your age. I was from an abusive childhood home as well when I was a kid. And my mom died when I was 10. And so right after there, I started doing it. But when I got to be like your age, I would do it a lot. I still sort of do it. I used to have a blog on the internet where I would write these sort of free form poems, and then people would write, Rosie O'Donnell's gone crazy. Da-na-na-na-na-na, she's nuts!
As they continued to paint, the conversation got deeper.
One thing I know that you said is that you have felt ashamed of being a foster child and you've tried to hide it sometimes.
One of the reasons why I've always felt ashamed is that the foster children in foster care are stereotyped. They already think we're bad, so what do we do now? So I didn't want any of my friends or anyone to know that I was in foster care. Simply so that they won't judge me.
All the other kids belonged to the mother, and me and my 2 younger sisters were not. And they would be like, oh, the reason why you're in foster care is because your parents doesn't want to. Am I really that bad? What did I do to deserve this? And I always blamed myself.
My kids are adopted from birth, and they have a lot of those feelings too. They say, why didn't they want to keep me, you know?
And I explained, you know, when a baby is born, you don't know anything about the baby. All you know is about the mother. And there's one question to ask when a baby's born. Can the mother care for that baby? And if the mother is strong enough, she's able to say no, and please place the baby with somebody who can.
And Jessica has a common way of expressing her pain.
Tattoo, that's my pain reliever.
Yeah, which I have as well. And it's you find that a lot of people with tattoos were abused kids.
I have one here, and three in my back right here.
There's something about the pain of it that's actually exhilarating. But you gotta watch out because we're gonna be 80 years old and look like the person in the circus. Here's, I have one here. It's a big one. And let me tell you something, your foot is very painful.
Whoa, it's pretty though. It looks like a sandal.
With their artwork complete, I have a little announcement to make.
Guess what, guys? We are about to have an art exhibit right now, an art show. And you guys are gonna hang your art, and then there's gonna be people from the New York art world that are gonna come and look at your art. Maybe.
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 You never know.
You don't wanna miss the big reveal. Stay tuned for The Art Show. Welcome back to The Tyra Show. Rosie and I have been spending the afternoon getting to know six foster kids from the New York family. They were each given a canvas and told that they could express themselves any way that they see fit. And with their artwork complete, it was time for their debut. But first, we pose.
Let's hold hands. Why don't we do the motion?
New York's Art Society really took a liking to their work.
Yeah, I think that one's my favorite. The colors are really good. Like, I really like the colors. I mean, like, how all the swirls and everything. Really, really nice.
What it symbolizes.
I don't know. I'm thinking like dark behind him, bright in front of him.
Right.
Maybe it is a very good picture.
Bright future, right?
Bright future. Yeah.
It's like almost two different paintings in one. So it's almost like it's almost like you have two conflicting personalities on the same canvas.
That's a great way to look at things. Really nice.
It was interesting how the kids' art had a similar theme of putting the past behind them.
My painting, it has kind of like a horizon kind of theme.
And I'm facing toward the yellow side because I'm looking towards the future, which is bright.
Darkness means pain, loneliness. Light means a new beginning. And you make the choice to make you.
And sometimes a little positive feedback goes a long way.
I never thought I would meet, but Tyra or Rosie, it's like, it's amazing.
It's been very inspiring.
It was exhilarating.
It showed me that other people do care.
It was an amazing experience. I wouldn't exchange this, not even for $1 million.
Yeah, this is the best the day so far in my life.
Guess what? We're done. These are foster kids, and you should get involved in the foster care issue. Look up on the internet on how you can help become a CASA advocate or become a foster parent, would you?
We are taking a break right now, and we will be back with me and Rosie and Ruby D back in the studio. Can I get a holla?
Holla!
Rosie.com to buy this amazing painting. It's a masterpiece to benefit Rosie's charity, Rosie's Broadway Kids.
Well, Rosie, did you enjoy the painting session that we did?
I did. I loved it. Those kids are amazing.
Yeah, they're so amazing. Rosie's movie, America, focuses on the foster care system, and one of her co-stars in the film is the legendary Oscar-nominated actress Ruby Dee. Now, Ruby Dee is known for a lot more than just her acting. Check her out.
The beloved Ruby Dee, along with her late husband Ossie Davis, were considered the first couple of African-American theater. Academy Award-nominated Ruby Dee has been the star of stage and screen. But it's her role as a civil rights activist that has been an even greater inspiration. In her latest work, Ruby Dee shines again as Mrs. Harper in America.
I
love you.
I met you at Oprah's Legends Ball. You were one of the legends, and I was a youngin', and I walked up to you, and I just like feeling like I was in the presence of a true legend. Oh, and you're on my couch now, and I'm just like very excited.
Oh, yes, and I tell you the truth, I'm excited about the youngins these days, yeah? Too. So that's what a feeling it is everywhere I go to be about the oldest people in the whole room. The oldest person, you know?
Well, I'm no younger than the youngest person in the room. Do you remember when you were the youngest person in the room, Rosie? Didn't that feel great?
And yes. Now it's like, and those days are long gone long for me. Gone. I can tell you that.
Me too. So have you ever worked with Rosie before?
No, I have not, but I've watched her a lot on the TV.
Yeah. That's right.
And then a very close young friend of mine admires her so much. That's Atala Shabazz, who is...
Oh, that's Malcolm X's daughter.
Yes, the eldest daughter.
Oh, the eldest daughter. And also because Rosie is in that group of people, in that tribe, in that army of that growing army of people, the caring folks, you know, mm-hmm. who see something and they do something about it. Mm-hmm. You know,
like give $100 million out of their own pocket.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, we learned from you, all the civil rights activists. Oh, we learned from you.
How did it feel for you to see President Obama become our president?
Oh, it was just wonderful.
Yeah.
Absolutely stunning.
He was actually, was it the election was on the day?
It was election day that we were shooting in Detroit, and it was an honor to be with Ruby Dee and have her tell me about her life and what it meant to her with Malcolm X and Martin Luther King. And
oh, yes, and all that we were passing through so much. But the night of the election, Rosie, I had lines to learn, and I was with one of my nieces, and she decided, well, she was going to stay up. I said, well, I really have to study my lines now and go to bed. But as I settled down with the book, she comes and she came in the room and she said, Aunt Ruby, he won. I had fallen asleep. And then she came in to wake me up to tell me that he had won. Yeah. And I couldn't, it was like an electric bolt went right straight through me, and I got up and I turned on the television and I stayed up the whole rest of the night, yeah. And I forgot about my mind and everything. I cried and I listened and I watched and we talked and, you know, so forth and so forth. And the next day when I got on set, you really don't know this, but I still hadn't come down from that not going to sleep after the news.
Yeah.
And so I was discombobulated for a couple of hours and, so, but we had a break, thank God.
Yeah. No, you know what the interesting...
I just want to tell you this.
I'm not cutting you off.
No, please tell me.
I'm going to be quiet right now.
But I did really get myself together after the director...
Eve, yes,
was so... we had something to eat, and that was what was the matter, because I was so excited I'd forgotten to eat breakfast, I'd forgotten to eat everything. You know, so it was that kind of night.
The interesting thing is that you and I, amongst other legends and youngins, were at that the Legends Ball with Barack Obama was there. He was just the senator. He was just another guy that was there.
Yes.
And like, so we were in that room with him hanging out like, hey, what's up, Senator? How you doing?
Yes,
he's our president. Did you ever think that you would see a black president in your lifetime?
Oh, yes, because my husband had predicted it.
He did?
Honestly, we've been talking about it since Shirley Chisholm ran and Jesse Jackson ran. And my husband... we used to belong to a think tank, and he was a very gentle man, but he had a psychic thing or something. He had a great sense of humor, and he says, "Oh," he said, "Well, you know, we're gonna have a black president. We're gonna be a black man."
What would have Ozzy felt that you think elected?
It was an astonishing, but. It was he would have been amazed and so pleased. He would have probably been part of that whole push, you know.
Rosie, how was it for you to work with Ruby? How was it?
It was a dream come true because I've admired her my entire life, and our good friend Adela. You know, when I first bought the book America, I said to her, "I just purchased a book. I hope to make into a film, and I hope that you can ask your aunt if she would honor me to be in it." And so she said, "Oh, when you get it done, let me know, and I'll send it over." And so 6 years later, you know, I said, "Hey, you remember that movie? It's a go." She's like, "I'll call her up." And it was the only choice for that role from the beginning. Yeah.
You play Mrs. Harper. You play like the only bright spot in America's life.
Yes. Yes.
So tell me about your role.
I was raised by a stepmother. You know, I was the only mother I really knew. I knew my birth mother, but I met her about four times. But I was raised by a woman something like Mrs. Harper. Mm. She happened to be an educator. She happened to have studied under Du Bois. She happened to have taken in other people's children. So I had a lot in common with this family. And similar circumstances took place in that apartment building in which we lived. And so much of the story was familiar. To me, in terms of the foster homes, for the group homes, mm-hmm. and so forth. So I knew a lot about that.
Here's a look at the very important film, America.
Oh, we've been looking for you. You know what they say? You got lost in the system. But you're back. You're back. Reggie.
Yeah.
He's here.
Yeah, there he is. Look at you, boy. Oh, no. You're a man now.
Well, Miss Ruby Dee, it is an honor to have you here. And I'm even more honored that I got to do a photo shoot with you.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, so we'll be right back. Here's the picture. Check it out. Give a big thank you to you, Rosie O'Donnell, for being here today for 2 days. Two days. And the legendary Ruby Dee. Thank you so, so much for being here today. I hope such a good show forever. And everybody, now listen up. Please watch America tomorrow night, Saturday, 9 p.m. on Lifetime. You can remember that. Tomorrow, Saturday, 9 p.m., Lifetime. And if you want more information on foster care and Rosie's foundation, go to tyrashow.com. And we'll see you later. And I'm going to hug Ruby Dee some more right now.